So there's this little bacterium that lives in ticks, Anaplasma phagocytophyllum. It's a nasty microbe that causes a disease called anaplasmosis. Fever, aches, vomiting, and if it's not treated, organ failure and death. Lauren Farovich is a grad student at the University of Rochester, and he's studying tick-borne diseases like anaplasmosis. He wants to understand how these diseases spread and how to better test for them in people. Lauren is also deaf. His first language is American Sign Language, or ASL. That wouldn't be a problem for his work, except that if he wants to discuss Anaplasma phagocytophyllum in ASL, this is currently the best option.
A-N-A-P-L-A-S-M-A P-H-A-G-O-C-Y-T-O-P-H-I-L-U-M. Anaplasma phagocytophyllum.
Thankfully, there's a better way. It just means inventing new science language from scratch.
Well, I have my protocol here, and it explains the steps that I need to take for each part of the process. And the first step is for me to make antigens.
Lauren is working on a PhD in translational biomedical sciences. Basically, he does lab research, but also works on real-world public health problems at the same time. We interviewed Lauren with the help of a couple interpreters. They translated our questions into sign language and Lauren's responses into English. So that's the extra voice you'll hear. Anyway, Lauren walked us through his work.
The first project, I'm collecting ticks and I'm analyzing their global distribution and what kind of diseases they carry in what geographical areas. And that information should help me with my second project, which is to test these ticks about what pathogens they're carrying and develop a new diagnostic test.
Lauren is using a new tool called arrayed imaging reflectometry. It allows him to test a single blood sample for lots of diseases at once, like Lyme disease, Rocky Mountain spotted fever, and anaplasmosis. Basically, he prints multiple disease samples onto a small chip and then coats the chip in antibodies from the blood sample in question. If the antibodies bind with any one disease, Lauren will get a positive ID. The system lets him run about 400 tests simultaneously. Lauren's been in science for a decade. 5 years for a dual undergrad degree, 2 years in a master's program, and this is year 3 of a 5-year PhD. But all the while, science itself has been a language barrier that's made his work just a little harder than it ought to be.
When I really started to get into the sciences, there were, of course, there's a lot of jargon, a lot of vocabulary there, and there just don't exist the signs for these terms. There's new discoveries happening all the time, there are new vocabulary words being established, and ASL, it's hard to keep up with all of these new terms.
ASL is its own unique language, distinct from English, with its own grammar, syntax, vocab, you name it. When there isn't a good sign for an English word, it's common to just spell it out using ASL, letter by letter. But lots of fingerspelling is a drag. It grinds communication to a halt. Again, consider that bacterium, Anaplasma phagocytophyllum.
Fingerspelling would be like someone spelling A-N-A-P-L-A-S-M-A P-H-A-G-O-C-Y-T-O-P-H-I-L-U-M. It's that process of looking at someone just spelling over and over again the same terms. Students are going to disengage. That's not interesting.
The solution is to help ASL catch up by inventing new signs. Lauren contributes to two efforts called ASL Core and ASL Clear. Both convene groups of deaf experts in fields like science, technology, engineering, and math, also called the STEM fields. They discuss terms that don't have widespread signs, and they make new ones. So what does that actually look like? We asked Lauren to show us some examples. First, look at DNA.
DNA.
Lauren could fingerspell DNA, but now he uses this. The sign captures the double helix structure of DNA. You can actually see it in a way that you couldn't possibly in English.
DNA is a double helix shape. RNA is a single strand.
Or go smaller. Atom, proton, neutron, electron.
This is a sign for atom. In the center includes neutrons and protons as the nucleus, and surrounding them is the electron cloud. hence atom.
Each sign captures the way that protons, neutrons, and electrons all comprise atoms. Macrophage might be Lauren's favorite.
Macrophages are signed this way because our body relies on their function of cleaning up things in the body. They eat pathogens and other things in the body. They look like little Pac-Men, so macrophage.
Or there's metastasis, which is a little scarier.
Here's the sign for metastasis. This is showing visually the process of how cancer is spreading throughout the body, how the cells are going everywhere within the body.
The new signs that Lauren helped create are published online, so anyone in the world can use them. And thanks to the internet, there are more resources than ever before. There are other specialized video dictionaries, crowdsourced forums where signs are shared, more ways than ever for the deaf community to create and share language. But all these new signs are only useful if they're used and standardized.
What tends to happen is that a school for the deaf or a college with deaf students will have a word in a STEM discipline and they will create their own sign for it. It won't be the same as the sign in another institution. Or sometimes students will go to one class and they'll see one teacher using the sign that that teacher has. They'll go to another class in the same discipline and another teacher will use a different sign.
Jeff Poor is a retired professor at the National Technical Institute for the Deaf. He's also my dad, which is how we found out about the story in the first place. Over the past few years, he's traveled to schools all around the country to collect signs for the STEM fields, and he's helped build a different video dictionary altogether. Now, multiple dictionaries can lead to conflicting signs. For example, here's the sign for molecule on Jeff's dictionary. Here it is on ASL Core, and here it is on another site called Handspeak. But that might be okay. More dictionaries mean more ideas are shared. And in time, one of those signs will probably take over.
The energy, the process that's important is which one of those signs is the most useful for that language community. That's what happens when an outside word comes into any language. And again, it's a meritocracy. The best signs will win.
Lauren knows better than most that science communication can make a difference far outside the lab. The final goal of his dissertation is to make information about tick-borne illnesses more available to deaf people. The work is urgent. Climate change is helping ticks expand their territories, putting more people at risk. And often, deaf people are not well served by the information that's out there.
Typically, public health doesn't have that kind of system set up to make things fully accessible. So we want to make sure people are aware of the risks. And you know, often you see posters where things are listed out in different languages, but there's no sign language there. So it's leaving deaf people out and putting them at higher risk.
Ultimately, new science signs might have the biggest impact on the next generation of deaf students. Lauren thinks that they're often failed by English first education, but with the right resources, they have a chance to see science in a totally different light.
Well, when I was growing up, the teacher would fingerspell a lot. And it was a struggle to get through. I never really had an interest in science in academic settings growing up until I went to college. And I had teachers that were able to spark my curiosity more when it comes to science. And I realized that science was interesting and it was something I wanted to get into. And so I'm trying to change that with this group that's trying to come up with these signs. So hopefully that the next generation of kids won't have the same experience that I did.
So if you want to learn more about this, we put links to a couple of these video dictionaries in the description. They're really worth exploring. They will teach you a lot about American Sign Language, and honestly, a lot about science too. So check them out.